Please welcome our moderator, MP Karen Ellemann, Deputy Speaker of the Danish Parliament, Chairperson of the Danish All-Party Parliamentary Group on Sexual and Reproductive Health and Rights, and former Minister of Gender Equality.
Your Royal Highness, Ministers, Excellencies, dear guests, it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you to the opening of the Copenhagen 2021 LGBTI plus Human Rights Forum. I'm pleased that we are able to welcome several hundreds of you to UN City in Copenhagen. And this is actually the first major event here since the outbreak of the coronavirus. I'm equally happy to welcome everyone who's with us online. I can promise you all that we have done our utmost to make this event as inclusive as possible. UN City here in Copenhagen houses 11 different UN organizations that all have, of course, human rights in their DNA. In that way, I think that we are in the perfect venue for today's event. So I look forward to guiding you through our exciting program with so many distinguished participants. On your chairs, you will have found a small booklet with today's program and also with introductions to all speakers. And therefore, I will only make very brief introductions when calling them to the floor. So without further ado, it is a privilege and it's also a great pleasure to introduce our two hosts for today. Dr. Natalia Kanem, UN Undersecretary General and Executive Director of UNFPA, and Aaron Lefebvre, Director for Human Rights, Copenhagen 2021. Please welcome.
Your Royal Highness,
Excellencies,
Ministers,
United Nations Under Secretary Generals,
dear activists,
dear guests, dear people of the world,
it's a true pleasure to welcome each and every one of you to UN City
and to the official opening of the Human Rights Forum of Copenhagen 2021.
Welcome. Bienvenidos todos.
Bienvenue. Welcome.
I am excited to be here because we are all included. And Aaron, Tell me, what is special to you about this moment?
Well, what has touched me the most when I arrived here in Copenhagen just 2 years ago is to begin the preparations for this Human Rights Forum that is basically starting today, is on the one hand the positivity and support I have received from so many different partners, but also the governments of both Denmark and Sweden. And on the other hand, the heartbreaking stories we had to hear, some of which you will also hear today, from people in many parts of the world who still cannot be open about who they are or who they love. People who do not enjoy their basic human rights. What I wish is change. What makes it possible is that we are joining forces. And of course, I'm also excited about co-hosting with the UNFPA, with you, Natalia. Dr. Natalia.
Well, no protocols necessary because we're together. And what really excites me about this moment is the partnership. It's always a good day to be partners standing up for equality and human rights. And at UNFPA, which is the United Nations Sexual and Reproductive Health Agency, we stand proud at World Pride. Yes. Because when we talk about rights and choices for all, we mean each and every human being on the planet to stand proud next to the partner of their choice that they love, to be able to express the intimacy of a safe and satisfying sex life, part of our human rights, and to exercise the right to be who you are and who you love. I'll also say that in order for this commitment to become real for every person on the planet, we must pay attention to the leadership of young people, to share information with them, but also to learn from them as they transform the landscape. And in particular, I think for LGBTQI plus communities everywhere, it's important to insist on full dignity. It's about full respect, nothing less.
Exactly. And what we are very happy about...
Thank you.
And I have to say, what we are very happy about today is also the fact that we were eventually able to bring people from all over the world. It has not been easy. The last 1.5 years were pretty challenging, but I can tell you that we have people from every single continent today here with us, this week here with us in Copenhagen for the Forum for Copenhagen 2021. And I think that is basically the cherry on the cake when it comes to this event.
Yeah. Yes, because when we think about it, we've had to socially distance and be responsible here in the UN city. But through that live stream, people are beaming in from every corner of the world. Congratulations to those of you who made this happen against all odds. And again, a big welcome to the online as well as the participants here.
Thank you so much, Natalia. And I think this is our cue to leave the floor for MP Ellemann to be the moderator of the day.
Very well.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Natalia. Thank you very much, Aaron. And now it is a great honor to introduce Her Royal Highness, the Crown Princess of Denmark, for her opening address. The Crown Princess has for well over a decade been a tireless advocate for sexual and reproductive health and rights, lending her voice to those we do not hear and standing up for those we too often do not see. Please welcome Your Royal Highness.
Good afternoon, everyone. Undersecretary Generals, Ministers, Activists, Excellencies, dear guests. In poetry and literature, in music, in theatre, in film, in arts, in design, love has always been one of the greatest sources of inspiration. Love, or lack thereof, has led to wars, to the creation of alliances and has determined destiny since, well, the beginning. And why? Because love, in all its shapes and forms, is what brings meaning to our lives. Love is fundamental to human life and happiness, to human relations, to compassion and coexistence, to who we are, how we choose to live our lives, and with whom we choose to live them. You might be asking yourself, what on earth has all this talk of love got to do with human rights, a human rights conference? Well, the way I see it, human rights are another word for compassion and humanity, which you could say is love in one of its many shapes and forms. Today, as we are streaming from UN City in Copenhagen, let us just for a moment remind ourselves that the United Nations was created to prevent the atrocities of the Second World War from ever happening again. Sadly, tragedies continue to occur, and one of them the world is painfully witnessing unfold in Afghanistan. Today's conference is about preventing the persecution of people for what they believe in, for their ethnicity, or for whom they love. Already at the first session of the United Nations General Assembly in 1946, world leaders discussed a document to secure the rights of every individual everywhere. This evolved into the Universal Declaration of Human Rights adopted in 1948. From capacity, captivity, and oppression rose the recognition that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. Human rights are universal and fundamental in every human life. The original intent is clear. It is inclusive of all persons and to prevent discrimination in any way. Human rights do not distinguish. But that assertion, for far too many around the world, does not hold true. Even though we write 2021, too many LGBTI plus people continue to be victims of hate, violence, discrimination, bullying, and ill treatment. And this we cannot and must not accept. Sexual rights are some of the most intimate and fundamental of human rights, and are therefore at the core of human dignity and human development. They encapsulate rights to make informed decisions about the most basic aspects of one's life, one's body, sexuality, health and relationships, and who we love and choose to live with. Securing human rights also concerns working to end prejudice and stigmatization of vulnerable people and groups. Human rights are not secured by legal rights alone. If rights are to have real meaning, they must live and breathe. The thoughts and ideas behind them must be felt, understood, and lived. And we must protect them. Since the creation of the United Nations more than 75 years ago, we have come a long way in human development. However, many, especially minorities, have felt left out and left behind, overlooked, denounced, and discriminated against. But no one should be left behind in our shared development. This is the common denominator in the Sustainable Development Goals. These goals embody a powerful commitment to achieving a life of dignity for all. The right to be who we are, that we feel embraced and included because we all have the right to belong. There is no room for discrimination in human rights, just as there is no room for discrimination in being exactly who you are and loving who you love. A proverb from South Africa says, "Love, like rain, does not choose the grass on which it falls." We must be united in rejecting all forms of discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. We need all the support and commitment we can get in order to build a world where everyone is accepted and valued for who they are, and where everyone can participate equally, fully, and freely in all aspects of society. It is with great pride that I stand before you today to open the Copenhagen 2021 LGBTI plus Human Rights Forum, and proud that we can showcase our Danish values of equality and human rights at the core of this week's celebrations. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Your Royal Highness. Thank you. Now I'm pleased to introduce Flemming Møller Mortensen. Mr. Mortensen is the Danish Minister of Development Cooperation, but he's also Minister for Nordic Cooperation. And as WorldPride and EuroGames 2021 is co-hosted by Denmark and Sweden, I really think it's a great privilege to be able to welcome you in both those capacities. Welcome, Minister.
Thank you. What an important day, what an important meeting and forum. Your Royal Highness, Excellencies, friends, and good partners. This week, we celebrate pride and inclusion. We celebrate freedom and diversity. We celebrate the right to love who you want to love. But this week, we also are reminded that many parts of the world, there's no cause of celebration. In far too many places, LGBTI persons are excluded and denied basic rights and freedoms. They are discriminated, they are being beaten up, they are robbed of dignity, and sometimes even robbed of their lives. As a minister, as a human being, as a member of LGBTI community myself, I cannot tell you how strongly I feel these people, for these people. It's a tragedy. The work to secure equal rights and freedom is an ongoing struggle, also in our part of the world. But certain things we are lucky enough to take for granted here. The right to love the one you love, to show it openly, the right to essential healthcare services, the right to freely express our views and participation in civil society. These rights for and freedoms are cornerstones of free and democratic societies. These rights and freedoms bring hope, initiative, and dignity. That's why human rights and democracy is the very foundation of the new strategy for Denmark's development cooperation. The new 4-year strategy enjoys broad political support in the Danish parliament. I'm so happy about it. This is important in order for us to translate the strategy to action and change for people in need. With the new strategy, we will defend and promote human rights with a special focus on marginalized groups such as LGBTI persons and women and girls. Support rights activists trying to protect them from physical harassment and abuse, but also from the increasing use of online threats. Fight discrimination of minority groups, including those with HIV and AIDS. And we will include and have a strong focus on young people. Why? Because young activists have already shown remarkable leadership, taking action on climate change, gender equality, and non-discrimination. But for any of these to happen, we all need to work together to move forward. That's why I'm so delighted to see Copenhagen 2021 bringing together so many partners, decision makers, activists, Danish and international civil society organizations, global youth, and the global LGBTI community. Together we can shed light on challenges, find common ground, and work towards a future. A future where you, I, and all of us are really included. What an important day, what an important event we are having just here now, with the highest purpose, I think. Thank you very much, and happy World Pride 2021 here in Copenhagen. And I really hope for all of you that also this forum will be very important and very successful. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Minister. I know that you will be leaving shortly to join another meeting, but I also know that you will put someone from the MFA in your seat so you get all the important points from today, but thank you so much. In a moment, I will welcome three distinguished guests to the stage for our first dialogue, taking a starting point in a dilemma based on a real life situation. Our guests here on stage will discuss possible solutions to this dilemma that we are being presented for. What could be the possible courses of action? Unnecessary support mechanism actually in place? Can we do things differently? Or do we need to do more? I guess so. So for the first panel, it is my great pleasure to firstly welcome the UN Undersecretary General and High Commissioner on human rights, Michelle Bachelet, who is with us online. And there you are. Welcome. And Michelle will only be joining us for the first part of the session. And then she is joined here in the room by Erinda Balanka, the People's Advocate, the Ombudsman of Albania, and Tarek Zaidani, who is the Executive Director of HELEM, an LGBTI plus rights organization in Lebanon. Welcome to the all three of you. So our first session here is on SDG goal number 16, peace, justice and strong institutions. And what we do is that we begin with a video by Laura Inter, an intersex activist from Mexico, that will help set the scene for a panel discussion to discuss the issues faced by LGBTI plus human rights defenders and what states, the UN, national human rights institutions and other stakeholders can do to support. Please watch the video.
Did Soy activista intersexual, fundadora y directora general de
Brújula Intersexual.
Las personas intersexuales nacen con características sexuales, es decir, genitales, gónadas, niveles hormonales y o patrones cromosómicos que no parecen encajar en las definiciones típicas de masculino o femenino. En prácticamente todo el mundo, el protocolo médico a personas intersexuales incluye cirugías genitales y otros tratamientos médicamente innecesarios, no consensuales, invasivos y dolorosos en menores de edad. En mi caso, vivo en una de las ciudades más peligrosas del mundo, que además es ultraconservadora y poco tolerante hacia todo lo que sea percibido como no heterosexual o diferente. Donde vivo, hay muchos casos de asesinatos de activistas LGBT y de derechos humanos. También sigue existiendo mucha discriminación y violencia hacia cualquier persona que se escape a las normas sociales de lo que debería ser una mujer o un hombre típico. Así, he decidido realizar mi activismo de manera anónima por los riesgos que afronto, pero también como una forma de protesta a la sobreexposición que se hace de las personas intersexuales en los hospitales, donde se exhiben nuestros cuerpos desnudos ante varios médicos. Se fotografían, se graban en video, se miden, se cortan y se cosen, desde que somos bebés hasta que podemos decir basta. En toda Latinoamérica existen grupos ultraconservadores que difunden discursos machistas, sexistas, fóbicos y de odio hacia la diversidad sexual en general. En este contexto opresivo de las identidades y de los cuerpos diferentes, también se encuentra la experiencia de las personas intersexuales. Muchas personas son sometidas a discriminación y violencia, tanto psicológica como física, cuando en su entorno se sabe de su variación intersexual. Por ejemplo, mujeres a las que les crece barba o personas que cuentan con diferencias genitales, un clítoris considerado demasiado grande o un pene considerado demasiado pequeño. Esta violencia y discriminación se da en las escuelas, centros de trabajo, en espacios públicos e incluso dentro de la familia. Estas situaciones se pueden ver agravadas para defensores de los derechos humanos intersex. Hubo el caso de una activista intersexual mexicana que realizó un video contando su experiencia de vida para un evento organizado por la comunidad LGBTI. El video se distribuyó en línea con su nombre completo y sin su consentimiento, diciendo que ella vive en una ciudad conservadora y violenta con la diversidad, comenzó a recibir mensajes de odio, amenazas de muerte y violencia. Es común que las organizaciones intersexuales latinoamericanas cuenten con poco o ningún tipo de financiamiento y que todo el trabajo sea voluntario. También es común que debido a la discriminación que vivimos en todos los ámbitos de nuestra vida, no podamos acceder a un trabajo y salario digno que nos permita hacer frente a nuestras necesidades más básicas, lo que tiene como consecuencia que existan muy pocos activistas intersexuales, ya que la carga de trabajo es mucha, el trabajo realizado es poco remunerado o voluntario y los riesgos a nuestra seguridad son considerables. Queremos que los estados y las instituciones nacionales e internacionales de derechos humanos y los donantes, además de tomar medidas para poner fin a las violaciones que enfrentan infantes y adultos intersexuales, también presten mayor atención a los riesgos y las amenazas que enfrentamos como defensores de los derechos humanos intersex, brindando más apoyo económico a nuestras organizaciones y dando recomendaciones a los estados que nos ayuden a garantizar nuestra seguridad.
Such strong points and such a strong story, which actually, in a nutshell, I would say, captures why we are here today. I will turn to the High Commissioner to start with, because I know you're only joining us for about 5 minutes. But please, High Commissioner, we just heard a very powerful testimony from Laura Inter of this dilemma faced by intersex and other LGBTI plus human rights defenders. What is your office, what is the UN doing to address the dilemma that activists actually face when engaging in public advocacy and facing risks to their safety?
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm sorry to leave earlier, but because we have a very urgent meeting on Afghanistan, because you know what is going on there, probably There will be a high risk for human rights defenders and also for the people of the LGBTIQ plus community. To first of all, let me pay a tribute to LGBTIQ plus human rights defenders around the world. I want to say that I admire, I respect their work, the commitment and the passion to make the world safer and more just place for everyone, no matter who they are or whom they love. And thanks to your work, I think we have seen some progress in the last decades. I also appreciate the alliances that you have built across equality movements and which is now bearing fruits with increasing leadership of LGBTIQ plus people and intersectional approaches and collaboration with movements for gender justice, racial justice, climate change. But as we just heard from Laura Inter, LGBTIQ plus human rights defenders still face great risk to their personal safety and security. So what are we doing and how are we addressing these issues? Through our presence in 92 countries, we support national actors to improve national systems for protection of human rights. This includes ensuring institutions and legislation in relation to human rights defenders and the rights of LGBTIQ plus people, as well as advancing decriminalization of consensual same-sex relations and transgender persons. We'll continue to speak out when we see human rights violations against LGBTIQ plus human rights defenders, including threats, attacks, arrest, harassment, as well as discriminatory restrictions on civil society organizations and on organizers and participants in events and pride marches. We're also very proud of our UN Free and Equal Public Information campaign, one of the most successful campaigns of the United Nations, because in addition to the global campaign, there are many countries that are at the national level that are also organizing their own campaigns. So let me just mention a few: Albania, Brazil, Dominican Republic, Mongolia, Panama, Ukraine, and Vietnam, just to name a few, to raise awareness on the rights and debunk harmful myths or stereotypes, increase public support for equality and non-discrimination. We're also working with businesses to ensure the right of LGBTIQ plus people through implementations of the standards of conduct for business, which we launched in 2017. And we have already received the support of more than 300 companies. Four, we will continue to provide support to the UN independent expert on sexual orientation and gender identity, Victor Madrigal Bolos, who is making such important contribution to addressing this human rights violation. And last but not least, we'll continue to collaborate closely with UN partners to strengthen the UN's response to violence and discrimination against LGBTIQ plus people and to implement the Secretary General's call to action for human rights, which includes a strong commitment for the UN system to consistently support human rights defenders, advance protection mechanisms for them, and tackle the increasing threats they face.
Hi, Commissioner. Thank you so much. Of course, I had prepared more questions, but I fully understand and respect that you have to join another meeting. So we will thank you here and let you move on. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I'm so sorry I can't stay.
But then, of course, we're so lucky to have with us in the panel and here in the room, Erinda, I will ask you first, because what has been your experience as a national human rights institution to actually address safety and security concerns faced by LGBTI plus human rights defenders and support their work?
Thank you very much all for this wonderful opportunity that you have given me to be here with you today and to show our experience in that respect. I must say it has not been easy. This is one of the things that as ombudsperson, as a person with all the power and the rights and the possibility and the, let's say, all the immunity that my position gives to me, it has not been easy for me to support the people of the LGBTI plus community. And it has been, and then when I was trying to help them or trying to defend or to speak up for their issues, the amount of hatred campaigns that came against me was so big that only at that particular moment I understood what the LGBTI community faces in my country. Because it shows when you are under attack, only when you put yourself in the same position in a way or in another, you understand how difficult it is for the LGBTI community to live a life that they are supposed to live normally, because they are human beings that need to live their life normally, with dignity, and without being put under pressure. I must say that I was so happy for one thing. I have done several videos with all LGBTI community people in Albania, and UN actually has sponsored some very, very nice promotion videos, and I'd like to thank for that the High Commissioner, because they showed a different part or a different way of how we can be more normal, and then we can be there for LGBTI community. And here is Arbor with me here in from Albania, and there is Janie as well somewhere in the panel, so two LGBTI activists, which I would like to thank from the bottom of my heart, because they have been real human rights defenders in our country, and they have made my life and work much more easier.
Thank you. Tarek. This could be a very broad question asking you about the situation in Lebanon and the Middle East in general, but I would like to focus, of course, today to know something about and hear you talk a little bit about the dilemmas that you face between visibility, advocacy, and then safety. Could you please say something about that?
Thank you, and thank you everybody for having me. My name is Tarek, and these days I'm a member of the PTSD community in Lebanon. But nevertheless, I thought it was really important for me to come here and be part of this panel. So thank you for having me. There has always been a lot of tension among these three imperatives that you mentioned. But in the past two horrible years that have occurred, I would also add the issue of mobility that has really exacerbated problems. And the advent of the COVID-19 pandemic and the subsequent lockdowns have really exacerbated existing inequalities, existing violence, existing discrimination across the entirety of the Arab majority or Arabic-speaking world, if we can put it that way. We have not only seen higher levels of unemployment and associated homelessness, associated lack of access to basic resources, but also that silent and often neglected issue of mental health, which has also spiked during the lockdowns. And we've seen communities having to make the impossible decision between economic destitution and homelessness, and having to move back with their families to their ancestral homes, to their villages, and face persecution or have to go back into the closet. To give you a brief overview of what happened just in 2020 alone, in February we had a large wave of mass arrests and police brutality in Tunisia. 2 months later, in April, we had a devastating outing campaign perpetrated by an Instagram influencer in Morocco. In June, we had the arrest and the sort of heartbreaking viral video of a trans woman in Kuwait called Mahal Mutayri, who was arrested and tortured by Kuwaiti police. The month after, we had a Yemeni blogger in Saudi Arabia called Muhammad al-Bukhari, who was also arrested for expressing support for equal rights. And then finally, the infamous case in August in Egypt, when two witnesses to a horrific rape crime in 2014, they were witnesses who helped bring others people to justice, were caught and their phones were searched and found some incriminating material, allegedly, in order to charge them with morality, sort of breaking morality clauses on the basis of their sexual orientation and gender identity. So not only do you see this exacerbation, but something really interesting that we should note, that every single one of these cases had something of what is emerging to be or emergingly called digital violence. What we are seeing now is that, according to a study by PwC, I believe in 2020, just the first 6 months of 2020 saw a 70% increase of people using online and digital spaces in the MENA region alone. This means that what used to be safe-ish spaces, and let me be clear, safe online spaces were never safe spaces for us. They were never safe bunkers, but at least they were a battlefield. And we saw these spaces exponentially contract. And now we're also dealing with the very real ramifications of online harm translating to what is known as offline harm in terms of outing, in terms of blackmail, in terms of police violence, etc. Alongside that is the alarming rise of government surveillance and digital surveillance. And it's really manifesting in three key ways. Number one, we're seeing an increased number of entrapment by all of these governments that I just mentioned, by police of queer people online. We're seeing the confiscation and trading without consent of people's information. And we're also seeing outing, arbitrary outing of people to their families, to their communities by these very same governments. So if you want to know more, I would say that the Human Rights Watch has been doing excellent research and work on this. If you'd like to know more about the details, we don't have that much time, but it's a really, really bleak moment. Mm-hmm. And the only two countries I will end that had witnessed some positive sort of developments on the issue of LGBT rights have been Lebanon and Tunisia. Mm-hmm. One had its capital city blown up last year, and it's in the middle of its worst a social and economic crisis in its history. And the other one is sort of, maybe arguably, we don't know, kind of going through a coup. Mm. So bad news from the region in 2020 and 2021.
Clear speak, Tarek. Rinda, I would, yeah, good idea. But let's talk about the recommendations here, because Rinda, I mean, what would you recommend to other national human rights institutions? I mean, what are some key actions that they could take to better address the safety so hardly needed of LGBTI plus human rights defenders?
Well, from this point of view, and especially in countries like in the Arabic world, or in countries, unfortunately, even in Europe, like Hungary, etc., there have been some setbacks. And if there is no will or no support from the institutions, and when I say institutions, not only from human rights institutions, because I believe most of human rights institutions are in the same line with that. Some no, but let's say 80% of the national human rights institutions are very strongly supporting the LGBTI community worldwide. It is not easy. Of course, UN, it's a very big mechanism. Of course, Council of Europe, it's a very important mechanism. And they have to be there and have an eye on national realities and address these issues, because in this way, they will empower the national human rights institutions to speak up. It has happened in Albania for other cases or for other issues, not for LGBTI community issues, because thanks God, in Albania, we can openly speak and come in their defense and try to provide legislation to improve the legislation. There is language even in Albania that has quite a bit of problems with respect to LGBTI community, but we don't see as open front of the governments or the police, let's say, against the community. So this is something positive in our country. But what can be done is that we need to definitely have a stronger supervision or a stronger role from the international community with that respect. The other thing is that I believe probably the LGBTI activists, and I've said this in Albania, need to get the approval of the general population as much as we can, of everyone. When I say general population, probably it's not the right word, but when I say of everybody else. And this can be done, according to my opinion, by becoming not only LGBTIQ plus activists, but being human rights defenders in the general sense. Because in this way, they can gain the positive support of more people. So, and in the way of not being there or trying to be there for their community, if they show that they are there for everybody in terms of human rights, they will definitely gain more popularity and positivity for their work. And in this way, they can definitely, having a stronger voice, they will they will manage to go ahead on that, on those issues. I believe that as stronger as we are and as clear as we may be as national human rights institutions and institutions in general, the easier we will make the life of these people.
Thank you very much, Urinda. Tarek, now you heard some specific action steps and so on. I mean, I would like to hear your voice also here, because, I mean, what additional steps would you like to see from states, from national human rights institutions, from the UN and donors in general to support the LGBTI plus human rights defenders to conduct their work safely?
Thank you. So when it comes to states, unfortunately, I come from a region in which we don't have something akin to the African Court of Human Rights or the Inter-American Court. Our regional representatives are the Arab League and the Organization of Islamic Confidence, which is really sort of the wall of shame when it comes to LGBTQ rights, not just for queer people in the region, but all over the world in terms of how voting works in the UN. I would say the one exception with that was Albania in a couple of years ago, when your representative in New York stopped the consensus in the OIC on excluding LGBT people from extrajudicial killings and allowed her Lebanese and Tunisian counterpart to actually secede as well. This is an example of what happens when three badass feminists in the UN band together and protect all of us. So thank you. Thank you for that work. But to be honest, I'm not here to talk about states. I'm here because the past 3 years have, for me, and this is my personal opinion, sort of compelled me to think that we need a really hardcore strategic reset on how we look at LGBTQ rights and liberation, particularly in the global south and particularly in countries where we've seen civil and political rights become stagnant and where we haven't seen any breakthroughs. And this is particularly influenced, I mean, you always go back to your community for inspiration. And in October 2019, the Lebanese revolution, or whatever you want to call it, happened. And whether it worked or didn't work is a completely is off subject. But during that revolution, we saw unprecedented leadership and visibility of women and queer people on the streets of Beirut. And you will notice that there wasn't a single rainbow flag in sight. Not because of any problems with the rainbow flag, ideological problems, and not because anybody was afraid to raise it. It was because the demands of queer people in Lebanon were good governance, and to corruption, jobs, and dignity. They were not purely civil and political rights. They were also firmly grounded in socioeconomic rights. And this is where we must expand our horizons and also include the development framework, not just the human rights framework, in our work. This is where places New York, HLPF, and the SDGs matter. Agenda 2030 is an arena that we must not only show up in, but actually take over, if we can. And I don't have to look too far to tell you that how this has actually worked. In Lebanon, we've had, for 20 years, been trying to break this glass ceiling. We've been trying to get legislation happen. We've been trying to get policies and procedures through, and it hasn't been working. Up until we switched gears, up until not only are we talking decriminalization and legislation, but we started talking about jobs. We started talking about education, access to healthcare. And it's sort of predicated upon something that I told a priest once, where I said, sir, I understand that in Lebanese law, I'm not allowed to have sex, but I'm also not allowed to work. And he had nothing to answer me with. And the way that has translated on the ground is that when we now go and we integrate queer rights into existing larger human rights movements, the fundamental question becomes not how can I just change institutions to become LGBT inclusive, it's how do I improve the lives of LGBTQ people. My question when I talk, for example, to labor rights activists in rural Lebanon isn't, hi, I'm gay, what can you do for me? It's, hi, I'm queer, whatever, what can we do together for the labor rights movement? And how can we improve the rights of all workers? That has guaranteed access to spaces that we have been historically purposefully denied. I mean, the chaos in Lebanon is a ladder that we also have been climbing. I mean, I'll say that. But the infiltration that we've been able to have, the fact that it is now a non-starter when you say that there is no LGBTQ representation in civil society and in conversations. In the past year, because of this work, because of the fact that we've integrated ourselves into all of these existing movements, for the first time ever, the Lebanese in history, the Lebanese government actually mentioned and agreed to its responsibilities towards queer people in its report to the UPR process, and as well with the first ever report that the National Human Rights Institute in Lebanon did for the Beirut blast. That's it. We're not going back, and it worked. So we really need to do more of this.
Very strong, Jared. Thank you very much, and also very much in line with your point, Zarinda. So thank you very much to this first panel. Please give them a big round of applause. Thank you. And now I think we need to do something very difficult. We need to just have a short break, but you're not allowed to go out. So the break is around your chair. And what I could recommend is maybe stand up, maybe move your shoulders, look to the neighbor, the other neighbor, maybe even turn around. At least we'll turn on some music. Enjoy. We'll be back in just a few minutes. But please stay in your seats. Good. Thank you. Sorry for being this boring person who stops the party, but we have to move on with the program, so please. You didn't stay at your seats. I don't understand it. Wasn't it a clear message? Well, more or less. Please find your seats, because now I'm ready to introduce, well, she's busy having portraits, but I'm ready to introduce the second dialogue. And here I'm very happy to welcome on stage again the UN Undersecretary General and Executive Director from UNFPA, Dr. Natalia Kanem. Online with us, we have another participant. Yeah, give her a round of applause while she's coming. Please have a seat here. And then online joining us is Imania Brown, Co-Secretary General of ILGA World. And then on stage we will have Franca Cadet, President of the International Confederation of Midwives. Welcome. So in this trio, we will have a discussion that will focus on SDG goal number 3, ensure healthy lives, and promote well-being for all at all stages. And we will discuss what are the possibilities for the LGBTI plus community when seeking healthcare, what and how can service providers and their organizations do better, and who stands up for the most vulnerable. And again, we will be taking a starting point in a real life experience. We have another anonymous young activist, this time from Nigeria. In the video, we will be using the name Sarah, which is not her real name. But please look.
Life has basically been traumatic for me. And as a woman born in such conservative society, in a society where talking about women's, anything relating to women's health is something that shouldn't be discussed in a public setting. I'm from a society where you cannot discuss issues regarding to female sexual health in the public, as it's like a taboo and it's not morally okay in the society that I come from. My worst experience assessing sexual health was when I got infected with PID, pelvic inflammation disease. My experience seeking health care then was really terrible, because what was supposed to be a consultation with the doctor became something else. It became a judgmental session. It became a session where I'm being taken back to that conversion therapy again, like trying to preach me out, because I was honest enough to say, okay, my sexual partner is a woman. That alone has really affected me, that I feel skeptical about anytime I have itches or anything in my private part, I just go for self-medication, because it saves me the drama of going out there and being judged and the whole experience. I just do the self-medication. As a lesbian woman, I am from a society where being queer is perceived as a mental problem, as a spiritual problem. And I was outed at a very tender age of 16. Went through all forms of conversion therapy, the last which is marriage. Not having enough information as a young, less naive lesbian woman who has been outed, gone through all forms of conversion therapy, and just being able to break away from the forceful marriage I was in, and confused. I didn't have that information about my sexual health. But until I was privileged to meet one or two persons and the network of friends I created and colleagues, and being in the movement, the LGBTQR movement, gave me the opportunity. I was privileged to have this information about my sexual health. Like me, there are thousands of them, and the big question is, what is the fate of the Nigerian lesbian woman if she doesn't know, if we don't have enough access to information about our sexual health? Because a lot is said about the sexual health of gay men, of trans women and trans men, but little or nothing is said about the sexual health of lesbian women and bisexual women. There are thousands of young girls like me who didn't have this information and who don't have this information. So the big question is, how do we get this information out? How do thousands of girls in my community get to know that this is what is it? This is what is it? We need this information. Thank you.
So moving and so horrendous what this young woman has been put through. Sarah is with us online here today, and we had hoped that we would get the techniques to work so she could actually maybe comment after our dialogue, but unfortunately technique is not working with us. But Sarah, I'm so happy that you're joining us from the UNFPA office in Nigeria, so thank you for being here. Dr. Natalia, I would like to start with you. Sarah, she sought healthcare when she needed it, and she was open about her sexual partner being female. Could or should she have done anything differently?
Well, thank you so much. Let me just celebrate the fact that here we have an activist who may have been under duress, but we see the confidence, we see the understanding. We see Sarah saying, this is my body, and I'm the owner of it, and I'm the owner of my sexuality. So look, despite all the odds, that is an example of courage that we have to celebrate on World Pride. So props to you. And so let me also say, look, I'm, you know, here with all the humility in the world. At the age of 66, I was a young doctor working on HIV when pediatrics had to face the fact of so-called mother-to-child transmission. And I saw care without care, and I saw the value of acting up. I saw what an activist with a strategy can do. And your first panel, I think, was a beautiful example. So I want to thank that young man. I'd like to say about Sarah that she is young. She's still young. She was 16 when this travesty happened to her. So my first point is that it's young people who are transforming the world. Imagine my pride being here with the United Nations Youth Envoy, a strategic young woman, and all of the young activists who are here in Copenhagen. I had a chance to greet some of you earlier. Look, I put my trust in people like Sarah and people like you to radically change the mindset where we're begging for something. Your body is your own. Your human rights belong to you. And the question is not what more Sarah can do. It's where have we gone so wrong in the health system? And this is my second point. That is so unethical. And this happens all over the world. To take it upon yourself to judge someone else who comes to you for care. So I'm going to leave it to my sister here to speak to that health system. But I do want to say that when we talk about confidentiality, when we talk about trust and why people don't come for care, well, this is an example. This is an example where trust is broken and someone feels that they have to self-medicate. And because of time, the third point I want to make is that we also see the consequences. So it's great that Sarah is brave and she has courage. But the mental health issues that underlie being disrespected, you know, we see this when we talk about racism. We see this when the rainbow flag adds color and inclusivity. People should not be invisible. Why should we have to hide our truest desires? I thought that the Crown Princess of Denmark talked about compassion in a very sincere way, why allyship is important, but also why claiming your rights and understanding that this is an inherent universal principle. These values are universal. It doesn't change with culture. So what we would say is the false impression that Sarah maybe could have maneuvered a health system, it wasn't set up for her. We need to change that system so that those of us with responsibility, those of us with so-called power, understand that we are really here to serve, to heal, and to work with each other. So again, I think the momentum, as we all leave today and go off into our different corners, right? And I believe the exceptional work, to, you know, and I say this again with all humility, of the United Nations in insisting, and we have our special representative with us, God bless you, because in Latin America, I'm from Panama, he's from Costa Rica, in the Arab world, in the so-called developed North, These issues have to be fought inch by inch, and I'm very confident that there will be victory at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Natalia. I will get back to you very soon, Franca, but I would actually like to turn to Imania first, online Imania. Imania, having seen Sarah's video, what are your initial reactions from this LGBTI plus perspective? I mean, what really touched you here?
Thank you so much for the opportunity and greetings everyone from, I'm in Brisbane, Australia. Lovely to be joining you in a couple of days. But first of all, I want to extend my deepest sympathies to Sarah for the violence, the pain, and the trauma that she had to go through. No human being should ever be placed in a position where their health, or the health of their child is at risk by the authorities. This, what they did to Sarah, was an extreme act of violence against a young woman. Sadly, Sarah is not alone. Hundreds of thousands, millions of women and girls, including LGBTQI women, face these atrocities every day. Some, like Sarah, are fortunate enough to still be with us today, fighting, sharing their story, their pain, and their trauma, so that we may progress in our fight for a truly free and equal world. Most others are here with us in that room and here with us in spirit. And I want to acknowledge their presence here today. They are the shoulders that I and many of my other fellow activists are standing on today. It's important to remember from Sarah's perspective and our own LGBTIQ women, that there is no color to violence and death that we face each day. There is just an unimaginable, searing, blue, hot metal rod ripping through and coursing through our bodies, uninvited. The pain, the violence, the trauma, the judgments, the shame, the rejection, the scarlet lettering. You know, human rights, gender equality, the elimination of violence against women and girls, especially this last one, right? You cannot achieve and fulfill the requirements of SDG goal number three, unless this is addressed emphatically, not just lip service, not just faux pretend measures that need to be in consideration of a member state's religion or cultural beliefs. Enough with that patriarchal, dangerous ideology. That is why we are suffering. That is why LGBTI are suffering right now. It's because of that. And listen, from an LGBTI perspective, a recent study by Outright International shows just how vulnerable rainbow populations are in terms of their health, especially around HIV. In low and middle income countries, specifically in the global south, gay, bisexual men and women and other men who have sex with men are 19 times more likely to be living with HIV. Transgender women are 49 times more likely to be living with HIV, with around 19% of transgender women estimated to be living with HIV. There is a severe lack of data based on sexual orientation, gender identity, and expression, and sex characteristics. There is a lack of data for us who are facing stigma and discrimination in access to health services. You know, people like Sarah, you know, Sarah and many like her are the missing pieces that we should be holding states accountable and saying, this is what you should be doing, fixing this. And in Sarah's case, why is it that the LGBTI, you know, activists and organizations in her country are the providers of sexual health materials? Why? Where are the states on these issues? Your silence is completely, completely complicit in these atrocities that we are facing as human beings. And I wanna stop there because there's a couple of other things that I wanted to talk about, but I'll bring it up in your next question. But Sarah, you have my undying respect for the courage, you know, for the courage that you're showing in sharing your story so that we can progress in trying to sort through these issues that are heaped on LGBTI.
Thank you. And thank you for this energy that also you bring in to this day. Franca, I would like to turn to you now, because in Sarah's life, those healthcare professionals that actually should have helped fulfill her human rights, they have violated them. And in your view, what is the role of a midwife, and how do you see this important link to human rights?
Thank you so much for that question. It is great to sit here as a midwife, because midwives are, it's an Anglo-Saxon word. It means mitwif, with woman. And we are healthcare professionals. Truly, we are about health. We're not about sickness. But I do feel I want to speak for healthcare professionals in general as well, because, you know, healthcare is there for people. People are not there for healthcare. And we forget this sometimes, as if it's the other way around. As if, and I hear so many people who are really able to come up for their own rights, who behave in certain ways when they go to a doctor or to a midwife, because they feel that they'll be judged, and so they have to behave in a certain way to be accepted or to be seen as or getting the care that they should receive. And this is a totally topsy-turvy world. And I think that, you know, healthcare has become extremely institutionalized, and with that, it's got a certain power with it. It's very patriarchal, and we really need to make sure that healthcare really is there for everyone, truly. And midwives, we are the oldest profession on earth. We have reinvented ourselves continuously, and we are about the sexual reproductive health and rights for everyone. By that, I'm not saying that midwives are angels, because when I did my training as a midwife, all my books, all the babies and the women and the men in the books, they were white babies, and they were a man and a woman having a child. So we have this kind of very patriarchal training whereby we learn that that is what it is. These kind of images, having mixed images, having different images of life, that different people can bring up children, communities can bring up children, all that is not there at all. And so I always have that same image. All babies in the world are white, and it is a man and a woman who have a baby. No, seriously. I don't know any other books. And it's so simple to change. This is simple to change. So in our education, it's exactly the same thing. And I think it's very hard when you're always taught in that way to think differently. What I find fascinating as a midwife as well, I come from the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we have home birth, because the system is safe enough to have home birth. And I feel as a midwife the difference when I'm in a hospital and someone comes to me, they come into my place and they behave themselves towards how I want them to behave because they're in my place. But as soon as I go into a woman's house or a man's house or a group of people's house to serve them, I'm in their house, I'm on their territory. And I behave differently, I can feel it. I ask permission for all kinds of things. I just behave, stops my, it really, and even though I hope I'm sensitive and I hope I'm someone that would really stand for someone's rights, but my behavior becomes different when I'm in a hospital or when I'm at home. By that, I'm not saying that everyone should give birth at home. By that, I'm saying that everyone should be able to give birth as if it is their home. And for everyone to be able to choose when they want to get pregnant, where they want to get pregnant, if they want to get pregnant. All these issues are people's rights. And I think that is something that we have simply forgotten, because healthcare has become a commodity. And I think healthcare in many ways, the healthcare professionals in many ways feel the power. And we really need to make sure that it's no longer like that. I think there needs to be a redress. We need to redress the balance. And I hope that when midwives come back and show themselves more in healthcare, because we've conformed ourselves kind of to a narrow bit of birth, but midwives are not just about birth. Midwives are about the broad spectrum, that every person can have a midwife that can support you in your sexual and reproductive health and rights, whoever you are. And I think then again, we need to make sure that it's not so that everyone should have the same care. Everyone has the right to the same care, but we have to adapt it to who we have. So Sarah, for example, and many women before us, or people before us, might have a very traumatic experience of healthcare.
they might be bringing up children with other people around, and we need to be really aware. We need to be aware of their context and their background and their trauma. And I think many people from the rainbow community have experienced trauma of healthcare, and we need to be aware of that. And I did a bit of research into, kind of, well, research in general, hardly any research into the kind of care for the rainbow community, hardly at all. But I asked a few of my lesbian and gay midwife friends, and what I found very, very shocking there as well is they themselves are not open about their sexuality. So you find that within the midwife community, and I'm sure it's the same for doctors and healthcare in general, because the rainbow community, we're everywhere. And so also midwives. But often when you ask, do you tell clients, they'll say, I'm not sure if I should tell a client that, you know, my wife or my husband or the same, you know, they will just simply protect themselves. They don't feel safe. So that's another thing we need to make sure that we embrace our own rainbow community within healthcare professionals, because that will help us to see the different colours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Franca. You make such great points, and I'm trying to keep time here. I want to take a second round with you because I think you're so brilliant. But could you please help me? Just this second round is more short, right? So I would like to start with you, Dr. Natalia. I mean, it's gold coming out of their mouth, right? So it's difficult to tell them to do it briefly. But Dr. Natalia, please, just briefly. I think that one of these very strong things that comes out in the testimony from Sarah is the severe lack of information that was critical to her and still is to so many. Just very shortly, what can be done?
A lot can be done. Mm-hmm. And again, respect for persons, which is a principle of the United Nations, it's a principle of ethics, implies that we shouldn't patronize people based on who they are or how old they are. Because a feature of what Sarah said was she was only 16 when this traumatic encounter in her healthcare happened. And what we're talking about in Pride in Copenhagen this week, human rights, the choice of inclusion to me is not just, and you know, we heard earlier, we're not really knocking on the door asking to be let in. Power concedes nothing without a demand. Frederick Douglass back in the 1800s. Mm. I think we see people who are claiming something that belongs to them. Hans Linde, it's good to see you here because information is powerful. And a lot of the exclusion is I know, but you don't. What we're seeing and the travesty of how lies on the web can be used to destroy trust, we also have to reclaim community building. It's great that we're here together for this moment, whether virtually or physically in Copenhagen, but just like we did after the Nairobi summit, when we leave here, we have to commit to the type of inclusion that we will defend the right of a young person to know about sexuality. The political contention around simply knowing your body, right? If we're gonna argue over sexuality education, so a five-year-old can name their body parts and say, this is happening to me, all the way up to the confidence that it takes to have an exchange with not just your healthcare professional, it's going to be your teacher. You may have to educate your own parents and community. Mm. So the safety of young people to receive correct information and the ability of us who set the rules, if you will, whoever you are, wherever you are, the private sector must step up and say, we have the power of employment and we want to be fair and equal. So inclusion is, for me, part of that equation where we equalize that playing field and we strategize together. So this is a mainstream topic. It's not a fringe topic. Your life is not, you know, a marginalization. This is the center of the world when we're talking about the SDGs in 2030. You're on the leading edge And I think a lot of us have to follow the strategy that you will set here. So I'm very excited to see what you come up with. And we're not going to leave it here in Copenhagen or in Malmo. We're moving forward with a better understanding.
Thank you. Very clear points. Moving on right to you, Imania, because I would also like to give you this opportunity to just give us any forward-looking recommendations or any kind of commitments, anything you want to do differently or tell us to do differently or whatever. The floor is yours, briefly.
So, listen, this is my view, and I'm on the outside looking in. We're the activists. We're not invited inside, right? So let me tell you the view from the activist point of view. We need to wake up. We need to wake up and realize that we must have a human rights-based approach to health. That is crucial for improving the well-being and dignity of everyone. It stops the atrocities being committed against people like Sarah, those with the fewest resources, the ones with the least health, the ones with nothing but their humanity, right? We need to rethink and devise policy and act with an intersectional approach. You need to invest in multi-stakeholder partnerships in order to quash barriers to equitable health service. The health sector alone cannot do it alone. They cannot fulfill the requirements of SDG number 3 alone. We must intersect. You know why? Because all the SDGs, including goal number 3, for women in all parts, you know, it's woven in all parts of the 2030 agenda. And goal 3's targets directly links to targets in other goals. We need states. Are you listening to me, states? You better listen. We need you to seriously commit to once and for all end stigma and discrimination based on sexual orientation, gender identity and expression, and sex characteristics in the provision of healthcare services, including prevention, promotion, and treatment. We need opportunities for LGBTI people to build policy and capacity that is relevant to their needs. The principle of nothing by us unless by us. And what we need to even have a serious attempt at fulfilling SDG 3, we need to legally end immediately non-consensual medical procedures, including intersex genital mutilation, forced sterilization, so that women like Sarah can have some dignity and humanity in living their lives. We need to urgently repeal all laws, policies, and practices that criminalize consensual same-sex behavior and self-determination of gender identity. Why? Because there is a direct correlation between law reform and the advancements in social justice. It's not negotiable. We need LGBTIQ data. Open up your data gathering practices to allow us to be counted, right? It's not hard. Don't make it hard. We need desensitization and non-discrimination training for healthcare professionals who deal with LGBTI people. Like with the police, do that with healthcare professionals. We need tailored programs to what our LGBTI people need, not a one-basket-fits-all solution. And my last point, if we are to truly leave no one behind, listen to me, do not focus on the front and start from the front. Go to the back of the queue. Start from there. Reach those people first, especially Global South people, where you will find my LGBTI people at the back of the queue. We need help the most. That is how you leave no one behind.
Imania, thank you. Thank you so much, Imania. Strong points. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. People are standing up here, Imania, waving at you and thanking you. I'll join that as well. Thank you, Imania. But still, can you feel it, Imania? Yes. Thank you so much.
I'm so sorry I couldn't be here. I just got my permission to travel today. I'm organizing. I'm so sorry. But thank you so much. Thank you,
Imania. I still, Franca, I'm turning to you. I know it's very difficult, but you have important points too. You have important recommendations. And you are a very important representative. Thank you so much for being here. I want to give the floor to you as well. Please.
We need to listen.
Take the mic and give us...
We need to listen. We need to listen to what was just being said. Yes. We, as midwives, as healthcare professionals, have to listen. Yeah. And I think we have to, as you say, you have to be at the table. I think we need to demystify healthcare, self-care, going more into the community, and not having these large institutions that are like towers of power. Hmm. Healthcare is for all of us. It's not for healthcare professionals. Healthcare is for all of us. But I think the biggest message, we have to listen.
Bravo. This brings us to a conclusion of this second round. Thank you, all three of you. Give them a big applause. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think we need to stand up, right? I mean, we just did, but that was very short. Now you get this music. I think we have music coming on. Please move. Move your shoulders, move around, but please stay by your chair, and we will get on with the third session just after a short break. Music, take it away.
Try to
I am such a party spoiler, telling everyone to stay by their seats, and you're here in front of me hugging each other, and I really like it. Don't we all? But please, now you have to get back to your seats, because now I'm getting ready to introduce our last discussion. So I have to welcome the participants on stage. You might have noticed that now we have an extra chair on scene. So no one is joining us online, but everyone is still with us online. Thank you for staying with us. For our last discussion, I am pleased to now welcome to the stage Ulrika Modéer, Assistant Secretary General and Director of Bureau of External Relations and Advocacy at UNDP. Sorry, Ulrika, but welcome. And secondly, Jayatma Vikramanayaku, the UN Secretary General's Envoy on Youth. Welcome, Jayatma. And also welcome to the stage to Anbit Saman, coming from Bangladesh, Youth Representative from European and Central Asian region to the ILGA World Youth Steering Committee. What a crowd. Please have a seat. What we will do now is that we will turn to SDG 10 on reducing inequality within and among countries, reducing inequalities and ensuring that no one is left behind are, as we have always already heard earlier today, integral to achieving the SDGs. We will focus on inequality of income, opportunities, and access. And Anbit, maybe if it's okay with you, I would like you to outline the current situation for us as you see it. What are, in your point of view, the biggest challenges that LGBTI plus people, and especially youth, face in terms of inequality? Please.
Thank you very very much. Thank you very much. I could speak for the next 7 days about it.
I'll give you a sign when 7 days are up.
That's wonderful. Few things I would like to acknowledge. First of all, whenever we talk about LGBTI youth, often I see faces be like, "Oh, I'm not youth anymore." But I want to tell everyone here, you are. If you are youth, you're included. And even if you are not youth anymore, you have been youth once in your lifetime, and you have faced the struggles and discrimination and violence, maybe more, because we are in progress. And I really want to acknowledge all the people here for all of your wonderful work and being here. Thank you very much. Second thing, when we talk about LGBTI or LGBTI plus, often we miss out many identities and sexual orientations and gender identities who often, non-binary people, like I myself, gender fluid people, pansexual, asexual. We want to appreciate all of your work and also your experiences in life, and you matter and you are included when we say LGBTI plus. So I am a youth representative from European and Central Asian region. It's my second mandate in the ILGA World Youth Steering Committee, and it's been wonderful working together with all of these wonderful youth soul. And one thing is really important for us is not to just only focus on discrimination and violence, but also appreciate, celebrate, and also feel the joy of the work we do. And I think that's something we're missing most of the time in LGBTI movement, and talking about this bad thing happened, but we're having wonderful pride here. So want to acknowledge the joy as well. I don't look European. So I actually was displaced 5 years ago. I was born in Bangladesh. I realized about my sexuality, I think, quite early. I think my classmates realized it before I did, because they were like calling me names and saying insults, even being punished at my class by my teachers for not being a man enough. I don't care anymore. And also, I wasn't sure what I was going to do in my life, because there are so many interesting things. Like, you know, you can be a banker, doctor, engineer. Who would have known that I would be ending up as an LGBTI youth activist? That's the thing, what we do because of surviving under, like, the empathy and I relate to the struggles and violence. That's what brings me here. When we talk about challenges, it's so diverse among many regions, and sometimes it's about life, and sometimes it's about your fundamental basic rights that you know you are entitled to, but you don't have it because of your sexual orientation. I don't think that you would be any less productive at your workplace if you're gay. But I think that if you are facing violence and discrimination for loving someone you love, that will make your productivity go really low. And that's something employers need to understand. B, education. We need to create a space for LGBTI youth where they're able to learn with joy and want to learn, want to go to school. But sometimes bullying, harassments, and insults, dehumanization leads you to not go to school anymore, leads you not to succeed, leads you to depression. We have had today, we have heard from a research from Nordic region about how LGBTI youth health and well-being is affected for, like, in the schools, for them being LGBTI people. And I think that's something needs to be addressed. If the data shows in Nordic countries, it's alarming. How is it in Global South? And how do we communicate over there? I want to, there are so many things to talk about. I want to remember this person I met on Clubhouse. It's like you have a phone and then you click and then you talk and then you talk. It's been pandemic, so I met wonderful people all around the world. Most of them, when we talked about our freedom, talked about their struggle, and it was not nice to hear, and we felt helpless. One person I want to remember, Ali Reza. Just before International Day Against Homophobia, Biphobia, Trans and Interphobia, he was planning to leave and go to Turkey in a hope of asking for asylum. He didn't make it. His mother was contacted and asked to find his dead body. and that person who was living over the phone was not living anymore. And that's the reality of LGBT youth. Here we talk about freedom of expression. We talk about offering education, health, and all of that. And in some parts of the world, it's about life. It's about existing, being in the room, or being in the planet. I think we really need to care for the planet and the people of the planet. And that's why we're here. Thank you.
Thank you, Anbit. Thank you, Anbit. I would like to turn to you, Ulrika, and ask you what is the international community doing to address inequalities of LGBTI plus people, especially LGBTI plus youth? I mean, what works well, and what are some of the obstacles for actually making an impact?
Yeah. A lot of difficult questions you're asking.
Yeah, maybe it's a little wide, but yeah, feel free to, yeah, to pick.
No, thank you so much, first of all, for this opportunity. And thank you, Denmark and Sweden. And thank you, UNFPA and Natalia and colleagues. I mean, it's of course, incredibly interesting to be here and to have the opportunity to listen. But I was also hearing from you here, the leaders, saying yes and act. And this is what your question is all about. What do we actually do? So I represent United Nations Development Programme, UNDP, and we have a lot of action taking place. We work with development across the world, and of course then embracing the Sustainable Development Goals. But I was also thinking, as I am in Denmark now, that very early on the Danish Institute for Human Rights looked at the SDGs, because I think the human rights community were quite concerned, you know, are we changing, are we shifting the agenda away from, you know, fundamental human rights? But of course, what they learned and what we learn, and I also, as I listened to Tarek saying that we need a fundamental kind of reset here. We need to understand that at the core of the Sustainable Development Goals, we still have human rights, and we need a human rights-based approach. And I think that this is what we've heard. But we need a reset as well, a fundamental reset, as Tarek said, because we need to use that as a strength and entry point. And of course, UNDP, we have a mandate, so we work a lot with colleagues across the system and beyond, human rights organizations and so on, to see to that we can support legislation that is different and push back on legislation that is not accepting equal rights. And we know that we are in a time in the world of today, across the world, I would say, so this is really not only about the Global South, we see it in Europe as well, where we have to push back and advise differently and to say that, you know, we will miss out of so many opportunities if we don't give equal rights to everyone. Because at the end of the day, and I think that this was also what Tarek alluded to and what you have been saying, as we have been discussing earlier today as well, we need to see the talent and the opportunities of people. Otherwise, we will not reach the Sustainable Development Goals. And this is a rights agenda, but it's also an agenda about giving opportunities in the workplace, in the daily life, as we discussed also in the previous panel, also in relation to health and basic health and so on. So I think the trick of UNDP is very much to look at this as a rights-based agenda, but also use that as we look at, and data was also mentioned in the previous panel, you know, what's actually happening in countries. When we do the socioeconomic assessments, as we have been doing now and then coordinating that on behalf of the UN system, but also together with the World Bank, the socioeconomic assessments in countries that are suffering because of what's happened accompanying also the pandemic, we need to look at also data with regard to LGBTI plus people and what is actually happening. And as we advise countries and governments also to build their response plans, we need also then to see to that we introduce also this into the response plans. So it's really bringing the rights-based agenda and LGBTI rights, but also the understanding of perhaps the one standing last in line, as we were also advised to do, into the response plans. And here is where I believe that UNDP has a strength, because we come with this offer of socioeconomic development. But we can bring in also the importance of bringing everyone along. And not only bringing people along, but actually look at that these are people that can lead. We're talking about that you're included, but we also know that there are so many leaders. I mean, we have seen you here today. So it's really also to see to that some of the people who are standing back in the line, they should actually be in the front.
Thank you, Ulrika. Jayadma, Jayadma, I would actually like to ask you more or less the same question that I just asked Ulrika, because in your point of view, what is the international community doing actually to address inequalities of LGBTI plus people, and especially youth, of course, asking you that? And tell me, in your point of view, some of the obstacles actually, and how to make an impact.
Thank you, Karen. Thanks for the question. I think before talking about what the international community is doing, I think it's also important to recognize what the international community was not doing before that they are now doing. I think even the United Nations, the work that I do, the work that we do, has not been always inclusive of the voices of LGBTIQ people, especially LGBTIQ young people. And the UN has also sometimes not been a safe space for LGBTIQ people to gather. So I think we need to be very humble in recognizing where things have gone wrong and to actually acknowledge that we are working towards a better future, and we have a commitment to do that. So for me, as someone from within the system, advocating and lobbying to change the system, it is really a big deal, Natalia, that you are hosting this conference today here in the UN city, in a UN building. And I think that will... that will really give us a lot of pathway to maneuver as we move forward. Now, when we talk about LGBTIQ young people, and Anubid has really gone into details about some of the specific challenges that they face, and in the context of equality or Goal 10, I want to talk about the inequality to access spaces. Because I do think while LGBTIQ young people face access problems in access to education, access to health, access to employment, I believe that if we give LGBTIQ young people a voice in designing these laws, in designing these policies, and in designing the accountability frameworks, we will be able to find joint solutions through their lived experiences. So what we are trying to do in the international community in the context of the UN, and I want to say this not in the sense that we are doing the best, I just want to share it as an experience or for inspiration for many of the colleagues in the room here, is to really provide that safe space for LGBTIQ young people to gather, have conversations of their own, and self-organize so that they can bring their strongest voice in the most meaningful way to the many international processes that we have happening here. So for an example, with my friend and colleague Victor, the independent expert on SOGI, myself, my office with the Queer Youth Network and ILGA World, we convened something called the Queer Youth Dialogues to bring together queer youth civil society to provide a safe space and a platform for them to self-organize and influence through their choice to which process that they want to bring their voices into. Secondly, I think accountability is also very important. I think everyone talks about at the UN, and Ulrika, you've heard this so many times, leaving no one behind. And they're saying, oh, we are working to leaving no one behind. But if you actually look at the data and the evidence, no, we are actually leaving certain groups of people behind, even though we think we are not. So it's important, I think, to have indicators. It's important to monitor who we are leaving behind and why we are leaving them behind. So for an example, when we worked on the youth strategy for the Secretary General, in the accountability framework, in the scorecard, we look at UN in 130 countries and which youth groups that they're working with. And this includes specific indicators on LGBTIQ youth networks. So if you log into my website, UN Youth Envoy, you can go into a specific country and see if the UN country team in that particular country is working with LGBTIQ young people or not. And if not, you know who to contact. So I think these are... two examples of how we create safe spaces for dialogue and ensure accountability so it doesn't just become a talk show when it comes to including young people, but becomes real results and accountability.
Thank you, Jayadma. Again, a difficult second round because time's running, but you have very strong points. And I would like both to ask all three of you whether or not you see the COVID-19 pandemic as, well, a threat, but maybe also an opportunity to actually be able to build back better. That could be one thing you could elaborate on if you want to, but also maybe thinking about better collaboration between international actors and civil society and youth-led movements to actually help overcome the current challenges. If so, how do we do that? So it's a dual question, and you're allowed to only focus on one of them. And I would kind of just open the floor to all three of you. Who would like to start? Should we take the same round again?
Yeah,
Anbit? So Anbit, but very briefly, because we only have our 5-6 minutes. So that gives you 2 minutes each. Yeah, but this counting down, don't count because it's wrong. We're way... We have no time. You have a couple of minutes.
Let me say it very quick. We often have collaboration dialogue with UN state members who are, we call them progressive, but also with a lot of resources. I think we need to acknowledge colonization and how it affected LGBTI realities all around the world and have dialogue with 69 countries where LGBTI people are still criminalized and sometimes punished to death. We need to have that conversation now. We need to create partnership with UN agencies, civil society, municipalities. I mean, look at LGBT free zones. Cities can do so much if the state's not. And also, I think we need to bring media as a tool to communicate how we can reduce inequalities. If you think about a world which is equal, if you can make someone imagine this, I think there will be a lot less violence and discrimination. If you can make someone imagine when they are able to live free and live their authentic selves, let's not talk about LGBT alone. We don't live our authentic selves because we are afraid of prejudice, discrimination, and violence. And we need to make people free and believe and claim freedom. That's how we are going to achieve this. Thank you.
Ulrika. The same.
The world of today is in a perfect storm. We should not build back, we should build forward, because we wouldn't want to go to where we were, but actually to a different place. UNDP has developed quite recently, and you find it also on our website, a dashboard where we're looking at the socioeconomic consequences also of the lack of equality with regard to vaccine. You would know that in the least developed countries, less than 1.5% of the population has access to the vaccine, while it looks, of course, entirely different in a country like this one or any country in the global north. And speaking also about the access to basic health and health services and also for LGBTIQ plus people, we have a severe problem, because if the least developed countries were to reach the goal of WHO of 70% of vaccination, they would have to increase their investment in healthcare by 60%, while the rich countries have made investments in 0.8% to reach the same goal. So this tells us a story that, you know, we need to look at this as a global public good that we need to create together. We need to see to that we have vaccine equity. Everyone needs to stand behind that. But also that this is not only about COVID, but it's really about the health system and the services that we need to build on a long-term basis. Because at the end of the day, if we don't show that we can fix this, we will not be able to build forward better. We will not be able to build back the economies, because the consequences of the pandemic are socioeconomic consequences. And it's about basic rights for people, not least those who are discriminated. And it's really concerning. But of course, I mean, ending with a positive note, it's possible. We have the knowledge, I mean, but we know that we have a lot of knowledge about a lot of important things without doing the right things. So I think this is the time to really speak up. And there are a lot of politicians speaking about the importance of reset. We had the IPCC report. I think there were a lot of reactions and so on. So I think those of you who are activists, but also those of us who work as representatives in the international system, this is really the time. And once again, I think the Sustainable Development Goals, they are really the perfect framework for this, because they are based on knowledge and they give us the guidance where to go.
Let me try to finish with three takeaways or three recommendations. Invest, protect, ensure. Invest in youth-led organizations. Invest in youth LGBTI civil society organizations. I think you cannot expect in places where it's illegal or criminal to be gay for youth organizations to be registered and have 10 years of experience to access for funding. So you have to invest in flexible models of funding for youth organizations. Invest in comprehensive sexuality education. That is the key. I know that there is no, you know, blanket solution to every problem, but investing in comprehensive sexuality education might be the key that gets us to that solution. So please do invest. Second, protect. We see from the work that we do that many LGBTIQ young people around the world, activists, human rights defenders, are under a lot of scrutiny and retaliation from state and non-state actors. So wherever it's possible, I see a lot of Nordic ministers here, embassy representatives, UN representatives, please protect them, stand up for them when they need you, and create a safe space around them. Third, ensure that LGBTIQ youth voices are integrated in all the work that you do. Even if you are working in a shop, even if you are designing programs at the UN, even if you are a midwife, make sure that LGBTQI youth voices are not being left behind, you as an individual, by your organization and in the work that you do. And I want to end with a quote that I heard at the ICPD conference last 2019 in Nairobi by my friend Martin Gazzardo, and Martin said that the rights of LGBTIQ people, the bodies of LGBTIQ people, and the autonomy of LGBTIQ people is not up for negotiation. And I think everyone in this room and who are watching us online and outside of this room should be able to put our foot down and say the same. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, all three of you. Big round of applause for Ulrika, for Jayatma, for Anvit. Thank you. Thank you. And now, well, time's up, so to say, because now I have the privilege to introduce our last speaker for today. I'm thrilled to welcome Victor Madrigal Borlos, who is independent expert on protection against violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity, appointed by the UN Human Rights Council. Victor, please. Hello. So nice to meet you.
So nice to meet you. Welcome. How are you?
Just fine. Just fine. I've looked so much forward to be listening to you.
Thank you very
much. And you more or less have the stage, but someone told me, don't just give him the stage and just make, because then you have 1 week, right?
So it will be like that.
But I would like you maybe to say a little bit about your experience, the role of the UN going forward in actually advancing LGBTI plus agenda. Maybe a little bit about the strength and the weaknesses, please.
Thank you very much. It's such a wonderful privilege to be here today. I was a little bit nervous when I was mic'd in such a special way because I was wondering whether I would be asked to use an alternative medium, interpretative dance, or sing a song for you, since I know that it's been a great session. But I believe that everything that you've heard here today connects in a very particular way with the work of the United Nations. Her Royal Highness was making reference to the 75 years of existence of this institution created to ensure that atrocity doesn't happen again. We all know that lesbian, gay, bisexual, trans, gender diverse persons were present in that history, but they were not mentioned in that history. It was only until 6 years ago, when the visionary work of over 1,327 organizations in demanding that a mandate of an independent expert be created, created the energy necessary to acknowledge that sexual orientation and gender identity is an indispensable point of entry in the analysis of discrimination and violence, if we are to tackle discrimination and violence. And I see that as a principle of political gain that is one of the great achievements of this movement. I had nothing to do with it, and this is why I can say it with absolute sincerity. Now, how this connects with the work of the United Nations is manifold. I can assure you, we have heard the many elements of evidence that connect the lived experience every day of persons accessing health, accessing employment, accessing housing, and how when we look, we learn immediately that people are overrepresented in the ranks of the ones that are behind, the ones that are last. They're not only being left behind, they are being left out. But can we also explore the other pillar of the UN, peace and security? We've learned a lot about gender-based violence in armed conflict. But do we know enough about how armed conflict impacts disproportionately lesbian and gay, bisexual and trans, and gender diverse persons? Do we know enough about how the bodies of intersex persons actually suffer in this particular situation of exclusion? And do we know enough about the way in which these communities contribute to peace building and peacekeeping? Read the acts of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, the Peruvian Commission, the Colombian acts. Every time you have conflict, you will see examples of how sexual orientation and gender identity can also be weaponized in the context of conflict to ensure. Again, I know that all of what you've heard here today will allow you to connect with the true multilateral agenda. This is why all of the UN agencies, and Natalia, your work in this connection is so extraordinary. I'm also so happy to see Ulrika here. I'm so happy to know the work of Filippo Grandi and the UNHCR in this connection. This is not a marginal issue, as was being mentioned before. This is an issue that is present in all of the work of the UN and in all of the SDGs. Most importantly, this is what demonstrates to us what intersectionality means. This is how we know that the struggle against violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity is one of the examples of the struggles against injustice created upon layers and layers of histories that have been made invisible by those that have preceded us. We also stand in the shoulders of giants. Imania Brown, the wonderful Imania Brown, evoked this. These are achievements of visionary movements. So I'm inviting all of you today to understand that the UN, through so many of our colleagues, so through many of our agencies, are here to say vigorously present, and that in the work of the mandate of the independent expert, what I perceive is a point of entry into this analysis, into this never-ending perspective of diversity, where we can understand how justice will be built.
Thank you very much, Victor. Very clear point. And actually, yes, maybe we have time for just a short follow-up, because you are actually giving us very specific recommendations. But maybe here, just to finalize, because you are the last speaker, so no one misses out on these very important points. Please take the floor and just really emphasize what these recommendations, the to-do list for all of us, so we leave here and have it, you know, very, very clearly. And I mean, moving the agenda forward, I guess we can all agree upon that one, but also moving it forward in collaboration with the UN. So maybe you could give us it very pedagogically, because I know you can do that.
Oh, Victor. You're a trusting woman, and I'm not sure that I'm going to deliver that,
sure. Karen,
but just very quickly. I think that we need to be humble in understanding that no achievement is untouchable. We are confronted with those realities nowadays everywhere in the world. Regression and the threat of regression is happening everywhere. I think that we need to understand that standing ground in this field means actually being humble and recognizing that no context is immune to regression. Second, many of the institutions around this room, much of the work is the result of dreaming big, but it's also the result of dreaming together and of asking each one of us at each and every moment, not only who's left behind, but who's not in the room. So the exercise that I invite all of us to do, myself included, is let's look around the room and wonder who is not here. And let's make sure that we reach out to them after these four wonderful days of dreaming and strategizing and coalition building, and let's bring them in without waiting one second.
That's a clear message. Thank you so much, Victor.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was clear recommendations. So we have a lot of invitations to hand out. Maybe hand them out by hand and actually leading people into this very important arena. I have to say that this actually brings us so close, only so close to the end. I would like to start by thanking all of our speakers, and including not least those of you who shared such strong testimonials. And I would also like to thank our interpreters up there to French and Spanish, and the French and Colombian embassies who made translation possible. And then also, when you arrived today early on, you met a lot of young interns and volunteers who agreed to help us out today. So thank you to all of you young volunteers who are here next door. And then, of course, a final thank you to all of you to participate here in the room, and also all of you participating online. We're all together in the daily fight to make human rights a reality for all. So thank you for doing that. And lastly, let me introduce for the last time today our two hosts, Dr. Natalia Kanem and Aaron Lefebvre, because now you will officially be closing the event. Thank you.
Aaron, dear friends, it's been wonderful being together, and as this event comes to a close, we would like to acknowledge the fallen soldiers to COVID who did not make it. We would also like to acknowledge that oppression and discrimination caused people not to be in the room. We'd also like to express our solidarity and to say that as the event comes to an end, we know there's lots to do. So we've heard from Victor and from you what the next steps should be. For UNFPA, I can pledge that we will not stop. We will persevere until reproductive rights and choices about bodily autonomy is a reality for everyone, everywhere. Thank you.
And with this opening of the Human Rights Forum during Copenhagen 2021, we just basically started. Tomorrow, the Human Rights Conference will start in the city center of Copenhagen, where we will have different discussions and where we will release the Øresunds Declaration. Next to that, 101 Democracy Festival, the summit on refugees, borders, and immigration in Malmö, and many other events to which I would really like to invite you to engage, to speak with our activists, and to make sure that these conversations will be paid forward and will go on. I also, and that is an important mention as well, we are here in Copenhagen, we will also go to Malmö, but the Swedish and Danish missions abroad have done a lot and will still do a lot. There will be different events taking place all over the world in the next couple of weeks, to not forget about those that could not make it for whatever reason, because it is a world pride.
It's a world pride, and it's been an honor for us to be with you. You're making pride a living thing. This is not a ceremonial moment. It's about rights. And I, in particular, would like to acknowledge Copenhagen 2021 World Pride and EuroGames for organizing what's turned out to be a fantastic opening. Very proud to stand together with you. I'd also like to thank our sign language interpreters and everyone else who represents inclusion. Inclusion in all our beautiful diversities.
And then lastly, our special appreciation go out to both the French and the Colombian embassy. And unfortunately, in the booklet, we say Colombian embassy.
Colombia.
Colombian embassy that sponsored and helped us out with the translations that were absolutely necessary and very well appreciated. And of course, you said it already, Tijnboom. Thank you so much for making this available more widely, because, of course, you were included. So, merci bien. Muchas gracias. Tusen tak.
Now, last but certainly not least, I'd like to acknowledge that activists, parliamentarians, representatives of governments, ambassadors from so many across the spectrum, and our online participants are contributing to building the momentum. But a very special word of appreciation goes to our magnificent moderator for this occasion, the lady in pink, none other than the Deputy Speaker of the Parliament of Denmark, Ms. Karen Ellemann. Thank you so much, Karen. It's been wonderful.
Thank you. And then one last household remark for those going to the UK Embassy, for those that got an invitation, and all the scholarship recipients. Buses are waiting, so I think it is time for some drinks. And Dr. Kanem, thank you so much for being the host.
Bravo. Thank you. All the best, everyone.